Please join me in welcoming Kevin Lembo to the Milford Democratic Town Committee.
Thank you. Good evening. To begin, yes, you can run for Lieutenant Governor.
Sure.
Honest. You can do it. Now, I'm exploring a run for Lieutenant Governor, but you can run for Lieutenant Governor. The Lieutenant Governor stands alone at the convention. The Lieutenant Governor stands alone in a primary. And it's only after that that you're joined to the gubernatorial candidate and you run in the general election. And I think the reason that that is, and I hope the reason that that is that our laws envision a process where we're starting to think about, maybe for the first time in a long time, who the lieutenant governor is. Because, you know, sometimes lieutenant governors become governors. Yeah. And sometimes lieutenant governors who become governors are wholly unprepared to be governor. Yes. And sometimes after 6 years of being the governor, they're still unprepared to be governor. So it's a problem. So I am the healthcare advocate. I know you didn't know you had one. A couple of you do know because I know you, Barbara, Dick, our good friend, Senator Schlossberg. I remember standing on the green in Milford with Senator Schlossberg when she was first running, and she always tells me, you said you can win. And you did win. The healthcare advocate stands with patients and their families when their insurance company denies them access to care. So on the day that you need cancer treatment, or you need whatever medical service your doctor says you need, and the insurance company says no, you have somewhere to turn, thanks to your state government. In 1999, the legislature got really tired or aggravated with getting calls from constituents who kept getting denials from the insurance company, and they had nowhere to refer them. They refer them to the insurance department, but that's the regulator. And the regulator has a different job. So I have the distinct honor and pleasure of standing with patients and their families every day. We do about 2,000 cases a year, and that's only the tip of the iceberg. This past year, $6.7 million in consumer savings. That's the value of the claims that got reversed in the patient's favor. When I got to that office, there were two people staring at me when I walked in the door. I made three. And we took this sleepy little office and we turned it into a powerhouse of consumer advocacy in Connecticut. And for those of you who don't know about us, I apologize. But if you had needed us, I hope you would have found us. 2,000 cases a year, $6.7 million, $20 million since I've been in that office. That sleepy little office started really churning cases. We brought lawyers and nurses on board and formed partnerships with the patients and stood in their place when they got denied access to care. So one of the reasons that I'm taking a look at a run for Lieutenant Governor is I think healthier is going to be a big thing in 2011. I think it's a big thing in 2010. I think it was a big thing in 2008. Connecticut buys healthcare in about a half a dozen different ways that don't talk to each other. Connecticut buys pharmaceuticals in about six different ways that don't talk to each other. We're spending a boatload of money. And the first reaction when we hit an economic crisis is to sort of cut at the most vulnerable, easy pickings, big buckets, instead of really reforming the way we do things. So I'm hoping to bring some of that sort of entrepreneurial inside government spirit into the office of Lieutenant Governor. Because it's going to have to be a policy partner to the governor. Things are that broken. We can't take a constitutional office that we pay for with our tax dollars and let it cut ribbons and go to funerals. It's just a really bad use of your money and mine. And I would argue if that's what we're going to have it do, maybe we don't need it. But it is. It exists, and it's there for a reason. Before I was the healthcare advocate, I was the assistant state comptroller under our good and mutual friend, Nancy Wyman. And I learned a lot from Nancy Wyman in the 7 years that we were together. I learned a lot about reading the budget. I learned the trick of you read the back of the budget first. You don't fuss with the numbers. You go to look for the dirty, nasty stuff in the back of the budget, because that's where all the interesting stuff is. But I learned something perhaps more important. Two things. That two things in politics matter. Loyalty and your word. And I think I've been successful in the work that I do because I try to keep my word every day. I try to return calls. I try to make government efficient. You know, we're Democrats. We're not afraid of government. We don't hate government like the other side. But we also want it to be efficient. We want to make sure that the tax dollar that we spend is put to good use. And I think we can do that. So healthcare is not theoretical for me, but there are other things I care about. Government efficiency, customer service. How was your interaction with your government? Has anybody ever asked you that? How can we make things better? And how do we actually integrate that into what we do? Governor's gonna have to be a visionary. He's gonna have to sort of inspire us to go in a new direction. But he's also, he or she, maybe, is also gonna have to be a technical person, someone who understands how government works, how it can work better, and then to make those changes as they're appropriate. And then the third piece of what a governor is going to need to do is to be strong politically. I like a hard political fight. It's part of what I do. Governor didn't like the work that we were doing. Governor didn't like getting leaned on by the insurance industry. And she moved against us to eliminate us. Took us on. Didn't cut us a little bit. Zeroed us out completely. And never had the courage to call me and say it was happening. I had to hear about it from a reporter. But we had built such a coalition over time, and we had built such great relationships in the legislature with Dick Roy, and with Barbara wasn't there yet, but with Gail, that we were able to pull these coalitions together. That's the same kind of work that's gonna have to happen to get us out of where we are now. This all isn't theoretical for me. I sort of remember as a kid, my mother was an OPEIU, AFL, now she's a retiree, and my stepfather was a machinist. And so I was the kid who had to clean the shavings out of the beds of the lathes, you know, on the weekends. And he got injured. And we sat at the kitchen table, and I remember them opening that Blue Cross and Blue Shield bill, and they couldn't pay it. But they had to, because he needed ongoing care. So I became that kid whose pants were too short because they couldn't keep up. That shouldn't happen. That shouldn't happen in our nation. That shouldn't happen in our country, in our state. And we have the potential to fix it. Our federal conversation has gone completely off the tracks. And we can assign blame in a couple of places for that. But Connecticut's got an opportunity to do that itself. We may not need federal intervention to do that. So I'm working on that. I'm working on sustenance. I'm working on anti-rescission language in our law. I'm working on things that impact people's lives every day, and trying to do the best possible job that I can do. So exploring a run for Lieutenant Governor is unique to me. I'm not naive. I understand that sometimes the day before the convention, the gubernatorial candidate will stand up and say, have you met Louie? Louie, come on up. You're my Lieutenant Governor. I think we need a more thoughtful practice and a process to get through that. Sometimes it's a political calculation. But I think it needs to be a little bit more substantive, especially when we're in the situation that we're in right now. So I like the political fight. I'm happy to have it. I like the policy. I know how to run things. I'm one of the few folks who's actually run government agencies and understand how all that works. And I want to take that to this office and be a real policy partner to the next governor, because they're going to need it. And I commit to you that if I can gain your support, I will work every day, as I do now, and twice as hard to try to make Connecticut a better place for us and for our kids and for the generation that comes behind them. So, thank you. It's really good to be with you.
Questions for Kevin?
Yes.
Kevin, my name is Brian. I appreciate the fact that you touched on a bit on your own family background and history. And I wondered if you could just touch on where you're from,
sure,
and what your political activities have been over the years.
Sure.
Thanks.
I live in Guilford now. We've been there for about 10 years. I am on the town committee. I served on the planning and zoning, but it was very local. Most of the work that I've done over the years has been state level work and federal work. And I've worked pretty closely on the healthcare reform proposals. We actually helped to, fingers on keys, write a number of those pages. Lifelong Democrat, Democratic family, stuffed envelopes at the kitchen table as a kid. My entrance into Connecticut politics was only a decade ago. And I came up late in the 98 election cycle. I had friends at the DNC, and Barbara Cannelli's campaign was sort of coming to an end in September, and they asked me to come up and try to sort of do some messaging and try to help. And that's when I asked Nancy, when I met Nancy, and Nancy asked me to stay. So if I learned Connecticut politics anywhere, it was with Nancy.
Great part.
Yeah, you know, I would never have left, and there are days where I get up in the morning and wish I was still there every day. She is one of the few people in politics today who does those things. She is loyal, and she keeps her word. And many of us have nudged her to move up and on, and she is happy doing what she's doing. And we're all better for it. So, thank you. Appreciate it, Brian.
Other questions? John?
You know, it sounds like you want to redefine the Lieutenant Governor's office. So I want to push it to go a little further than that. So you, first of all, if you're going to rename it, what would it be to match the vision you have? What would it look like?
Well, you know, I wouldn't necessarily try to rename the office. I mean, the office is what the office is. But I think there's an argument to be made that the people of the state need an internal advocate within their government. So if you take what I do now as the healthcare advocate, and I sort of work within the systems to help people get the outcomes that are appropriate, if we can take that advocacy role into the Lieutenant Governor's office, could that be a place where people react and file complaints and talk about ways to make things better and build coalitions? So maybe there can be an active, activist Lieutenant Governor in our government that is directly linked to sort of what's going on in people's minds and in their hearts, and then to inform the governor and their cabinet about what's going on. Because, you know, when you're working inside government, it gets a little, you know, you stop listening. When you hold public hearings at 10 o'clock on a Tuesday morning, you hear from a certain subset of people. When you hold public hearings at 7 o'clock or 7:30 on a Thursday night, you hear a different perspective sometimes. And if you don't get out there at 7:30 on a Thursday night, your view of the world gets really skewed really fast. So I don't want to be so presumptuous as to say, you know, I demand, I want to do this, I want to do that, because I really wanted to be that policy partner to the governor. But there is an opportunity here to sort of take that office, not overblow it, but activate it in a way that really is useful for the people. And again, I really feel strong that if we're not going to do that, we should have another conversation about that office. There are plenty of states that do without them.
Other questions? Gail?
I don't have a question. I just need to stand up and just tell you just a little bit about Kevin outside of what he said, just so that you know. I know there are a lot of people who really haven't heard of his office, but I can tell you, as the senator who represents Milford, Orange, and West Haven, I've gotten so many phone calls from people literally at the hospital saying, the insurance company has said no, my husband's going to die, my child is not getting care. And the last time this happened to me, I made two phone calls. I made one to Kevin, and I made the other phone call to the insurance department, because they're supposed to have an advocate to do that does the exact same thing. Well, I can tell you something. I didn't get a phone call even back from the insurance department before Kevin had it solved and had the people on their way to getting the care that they had paid for. And it's not just once. It is countless. And I wouldn't stand up at this point, because I know everybody really, you know, we want to hear from everybody. But people, you really, I can't tell you how important his job is that he's doing right now, but how well he has done it, and how many people from our town, from Milford, that he has helped in the way that he does his job. It has been my honor and my pleasure to work with him. He's great on policy, really, really terrific, smart on the politics. But most importantly, always there when the people of this town has needed his help. So I thank you for that, Kevin.
Yeah. Just one final thought related to that. Inadequate gubernatorial leadership is not a zero sum. It doesn't sort of just remain static. It causes real harm. We had a rescission bill this past year that would have forced insurers to take rescissions when they pull policies away from you because you get sick, to the insurance department to at least get a third set of eyes on it. Passed the Senate 36-0, passed the House 112-36. Governor Rell vetoed that bill and said it would encourage patients to lie. a cancer survivor who should know better. This is not leadership. This is bowing to the pressure of others and not us. So thank you, and I'm going to.